Have you ever eaten mushrooms you really should have left alone? Desperation makes a person do wild things, even if you're risking death, a psychedelic experience, or a mediocre experience with dirty fungi. But what if I told you there was a fourth mushroom experience? All you have to do is commit an act of sadistic murder as opposed to not sadistic murder and spill a bunch of blood on the ground. Spit on the ground, turn around three times, say, Bob Giranko, and presto! That night, you'll have a lovely crop of blood mushrooms that moonlight will turn into murder! Welcome back to the Compendium of Monsters. It's Redcap and MADCAP week. Before we continue, go crazy on that subscribe button because otherwise these fae are gonna get you. Just kidding, but subscribing helps me out a lot. Redcaps and MADCAPs are challenge level 3 and they are in no way comparable to toddlers. These fae have an armor class of 13, average hit points of 45, a speed of 25 feet, and dark vision out to 60 feet. While Redcaps can talk in common or sylvan, the latter is particularly useful when Redcaps communicate with each other or creatures from the Feywild. In case those clodhoppers weren't obvious, a Redcap's feet are about one-third the size of its body and are clad in solid iron. Not that they ever need to take off their boots, despite having disadvantage on stealth checks when clanking around, because redcaps don't have a long life expectancy. I mean, look at those chompers. I would expect to be gumming my food in short order if I had a mouth like that. Despite their small size, however, redcaps have viciously deceptive strength and are afforded grappling rules of a medium-sized creature. Redcaps can also pick up heavy weapons and use them without disadvantage on their attack rolls. Lay off the steroids, mang. Redcaps have a triple multi-attack, which at challenge level 3 is a huge f*** you to anyone fought by one at an appropriate level. Assuming all attacks hit, the minimum damage a redcap could deal is 18, the average damage is 27, and the maximum damage is 36. A barbarian at level 3 who amazingly high-rolled their health increases wouldn't have much more than 40 hit points, and their hit die is a d12. For their other action, Ironbound Pursuit, redcaps can use their movement speed to chase down an offending target and heave their body boots first at them.
Red Smash!
This target has to succeed on a dexterity saving throw to get out of the way or take a massive amount of bludgeoning damage and get knocked prone. And how embarrassing would that be? Imagine you're playing a 7-foot-tall Goliath and something the height of your kneecap slams you to the ground. Don't dump dexterity. I lament that redcaps have lost their range attack option between 3rd and 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons. They should get their slings back, but also a bite attack. Look at those f***ing chompers. They're not as great as a maw demons, but what savage creature wouldn't use its teeth to maul a nearby opponent? Hell, if I thought it would make a difference in a fight, I'd probably bite someone.
Improvise. Adapt. Overcome.
Redcaps are born at the site of excessive slaughter, usually when a sentient creature deliberately murders another creature in the Feywild, or where the Feywild touches the material plane. If you're not familiar with the Feywild, it's related to the Shadowfell, except it's the polar opposite of depressive. Manic doesn't do the realm justice, but this picture captures the essence of the two locations. Redcaps are homicidal assholes that have been around since 3rd edition Dungeons & Dragons, though it appears they didn't get updated for 3.5 in 4th edition. Redcaps' motivations are slightly different than someone who kills for pleasure. Just kidding, redcaps kill for pleasure, but they also kill to survive. See, these demented d***heads have to soak their stupid hats in fresh blood once every 3 days or they vanish into nothingness, no matter how many corpses they've left in their wake. Couldn't they just soak their hats in a small flesh wound and not be so murderous? No, absolutely not. These hats need to be drenched in blood for the redcap to not get the vanish. Redcaps gain strength as they make kills, which allows them to increase their armor rating, damage, health, and generally make them nearly impossible to kill without cold iron weapon.
Zenzos to you. Cold wrought iron does not just mean an iron weapon that is cool to the touch. Oh ho ho ho! Many swords learn the truth the hard way. The dead way. Ta-ta, bye-bye.
Granted, this isn't canon for 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons, but just keep this in mind if your DM drags you to Phandalin and mentions cold iron. Fun fact, Holy Avenger weapons are typically made of cold iron and deity essence, but that's usually trivial to obtain, right? Redcaps aren't generally found in groups, preferring to engage in total carnage by themselves, though they can be united by particularly powerful entities like hags, spellcasters, or archfey, so long as those entities provide payment in the form of victims. If you try to suppress a redcap's natural urge to kill, you're probably next. Killing redcaps used to leave part of their bodies behind. A single tooth. It's rumored that if you wear this tooth, fae, especially redcaps, treat you with slightly more positive disposition. Why? Beats me, but I assume their lack of explanation for the encouragement of Barakas-like trophy-taking was why it was removed for 5th edition. If you know the actual answer why, please leave a comment, as now we're all curious. Otherwise, it's safe to assume that no fae likes redcaps, but everyone recognizes the inevitability of their existence. Now, there might have been a slight detail I purposefully haven't mentioned, and it's when you let a redcap do the unthinkable, soak its hat in demon ichor. Not only is this not physically harmful to the redcap, it actually accentuates the redcap's worst traits, psychotic behavior and violence. This descent into madness is named predictably MADCAP. Madcaps are more likely to band together than redcaps, given that the demons they now depend on for sustenance can be tricky to kill, and there's usually enough ichor available for everyone. Groups of madcaps have the tendency to bond over mutual hatreds and will react with excessive violence if the thing they hate is recognizably near. Things madcaps hate can be music, creatures with curly hair, chinchillas, the word cool, the color blue, Karens, Richards, boomers, The list goes on, really. It's important to note that madcaps can sustain their existence with both normal and demonic blood, making them equal opportunity assholes in case they haven't recently gotten their bleed on. Despite my personal dislike of the carnage caused by redcaps, madcaps are a great, relatively sustainable method of keeping redcaps alive. Sure, you have the added crazy and what have you, but demons are never in short supply. Just hang out in Avernus! With the blood war raging, an enterprising individual could probably sustain an empire of madcaps. The best part of using Avernus is you get praise from the devils for killing demons, and the demons go respawn in the abyss to come back to feed your madcaps again and again. Talk about eating your cake and eating it. And eating it. Cake for everyone! Oprah style! Just bear in mind when madcaps are reduced to 0 hit points, they explode violently in a burst of flame, leaving behind their smoldering weapon and boots. Granted, this is just a cosmetic effect, but you could easily add some d6s of fire damage for an additional f*** you. DMs, redcaps and madcaps are another one of those point-and-swing creatures that you don't have to plan too strategically except for two situations. One is the approach, and one is if your party knows of redcaps and chooses not to kill them. Redcaps and madcaps are smart enough to stay stationary and hidden until prey are close enough to charge, in which case they always open with their ironbound pursuit action. Remember, ironbound pursuit does not require the redcap to travel in a straight line. Getting killed is a bother to a redcap, but it operates on a kill-or-be-killed system and would rather not have to worry about soaking its hat for 3 days. You could, if you want to horrify your players, have a single redcap gain a percentage of its missing hit points after it soaks its hat in a fresh kill's blood. Depending on the strength of targets available, this does amplify the redcap's challenge level to 4 or possibly a 5. The main hassle of redcaps is if your party lets one live. You then need to figure out who the redcap is going to kill, knowing that it kills every 3 days at the latest. It's a hassle, but can be used to finish off creatures you don't need in your story in the off chance there's too many bodies active in your campaign. Players! Nuke it. Kill it with fire. Redcaps and madcaps are going to take you apart at level 3, and there's not a lot you can do about it unless you have plate armor, which most of you probably won't. If you're squishy, stay 30 or more feet away from the nearest redcap and pepper it with all the offensive spells, arrows, rocks, whatever you have on hand. Redcaps can knock you on your ass without having to travel in a straight line, so don't think about standing to the side or standing too close is going to help you. That only works on minotaurs and garistros. Not that I would be caught standing near a garistro for any reason whatsoever. God grand incarnate. Anyways, what do you all think about redcaps and madcaps? Are you team redcap or madcap? Let me know in the comments below. A quick thank you to my patrons. And thank you all so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please hit that subscribe button, smash that like button, share my video on your Twitter, Facebook, or other social media, and make the leap to become one of my patrons on Patreon. I'll see you all next time.